Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We want to welcome you to our Sunday morning broadcast with Apostle David Spearman, Senior Pastor of Kingdom First here in Fort Wayne. Please feel free to share today's broadcast with as many people as you know. Also, feel free to comment if you get encouraged, blessed, or stirred up as you hear the Word of God. And use the emojis at any time to get our online activity to be heard throughout our time. If you're watching YouTube Live, display us on your smart TV for your entire family to watch. But now, let's get into this power-packed service.
We give you glory this morning, God. We just want to take some time to lift up our hands and say, God, you're worthy. God, we exalt your name.
Yes.
You are holy, mighty to save. Bless your name, God.
Lord, you are awesome. Lord, you are awesome. Sing, Lord, you are awesome.
Say, Lord, you are awesome.
You are awesome.
We worship you, God. We shout hallelujah to you, God.
Hallelujah.
Bless your name, Lord. You're worthy to be exalted, God. You are awesome. Bless your name, Lord. We give you praise, God. We lift your name high above the earth. Worthy, God. Worthy, God. Bless your name, Lord. Lord, we just want to take time to give you worship this morning. We want to lift our hands before you, God, and say, God, I am an empty vessel this morning. I need you to fill me, God. Everybody has been taking things away from me, God, but I need you to fill me with your Holy Spirit. I need you to fill me with your grace this morning, God. Bless your name, God. You're worthy to be praised, God. We just want to take some time, God, to sing to you, God, just to you this morning.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life.
You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside.
You thought I was to die for.
Die for,
so you sacrifice
God bless you this morning. outside, but it's not dreary in here. Amen. Sun is shining. The sun, the Son of God. Amen. All right, well, we want to thank all those who are watching by streaming live. God bless you. Thanks for being with us today. We are encouraged that you're with us. God bless each and every single one of you who are here. We're encouraged for that. We are going to move right along into our lesson this morning, and it's a continuation of the previous two lessons about don't looking back, but this one is entitled, Moses, My Servant is Dead. Moses, My Servant is Dead. So let's have a word of prayer before we proceed. Father, in Jesus' name, we are so grateful and thankful. We're so happy to be here in the house of prayer. We just lift up your most holy name and glorify you. You are beyond our wildest imagination of what you can do and how you operate, Heavenly Father. We can't even conceive of your splendid love, of your splendid grace, of your great power and anointing. It's beyond our comprehension, but Father, I thank you that you have revealed some of yourself to us and enabled us to be a part of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, we give you the glory and honor. Let this word go forth, touching hearts, touching lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I said, our lesson this morning is entitled, Moses, My Servant is Dead, and it's found over in Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. It says, Now it came about after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' servant, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, cross this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the sons of Israel. Now, it came time for Moses to die because he had committed a sin, but it came time for him to die. He did not hallow the Lord's name before the people at a certain event. And so he was allowed, the Lord took him up on the mountain, he was allowed to see the promised land, but not allowed to enter into it, all right? But the Lord, previous to that, had told Moses to anoint Joshua to be in his place. And so he did that. He brought Joshua before all the congregation of Israel, announced that Joshua would be taken over for him. Then he laid his hands upon him and conferred that anointing of leadership and knowledge and power upon him, so that then he would be fit to take over when Moses died. But that's one of the things that God does, and I just want to kind of divert here for just a second. God always has the present leader anoint the next leader. And one of the things that I've seen that biblically so many times, Moses and Joshua, Elijah and Elisha. And each time he had the previous leader anointed, he told Elijah, he said, look, Elisha is going to be prophet in your place. He says, so you go find him, and he's in such and such place. You school him, teach him, because when I take you, he needs to be able to step in. And that's what God does on a regular basis. God doesn't leave a vacuum. All right. God doesn't leave a void in the kingdom, in his churches. Or no, he doesn't leave a void. He always does that if we are obedient. And also what has to happen is then we have to be able to acknowledge that that's God's man and go along with it. Amen. So when Moses died, all of Israel mourned for 30 days, the Bible says. It says in Deuteronomy 34, verse 8, so the sons of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the days of weeping and mourning for Moses came to an end. There comes a point when God allows you to do a certain thing. That comes to an end. Then you've got to move forward. You've got to do the work that God has called you to do. So God comes to Joshua, and he simply says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Well, Joshua understood that Moses was dead. He knew that. They just got done weeping for him for 30 days. So he knew that. That wasn't the issue, that he didn't know he was dead. What the issue was, it's time to put Moses behind you and move forward. It's time to, and think about this. Moses was probably one of the greatest men in the Bible aside from Jesus. Absolutely. You know, there's no doubt about it. There's none in the Bible aside from Jesus who can really compare to Moses and all that he accomplished, what he did. I mean, single-handedly, by the power of God, he brought millions of people out of slavery, out of Egypt, and took them to the border of the land that God had for them. instituted all in Judaism, all the laws and everything that you see in Judaism, Moses wrote that. He literally just, you know, single-handedly almost did all this stuff. He's just a most amazing man. Obviously, he was anointed by the power of God and God's wisdom and knowledge to do all these things. But one man literally changed the face of an entire people. Listen, there was no way Joshua was a Moses. He wasn't. But that wasn't the issue. Because what Moses did, Moses did. And it was not time for another Moses, it was time for Joshua. Moses did what he was supposed to do, but now it was time for Joshua to do what he was supposed to do. And Joshua was a man who could go out there and fight. Joshua was a man who was a conqueror. Joshua was a man who could go out and lead the people into the war and bring them through that successfully. And so what they didn't need another Moses at that point. They needed a Joshua. Amen? So God comes to Joshua and says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, understand this. Joshua had been Moses' assistant for years. For years. Every time Moses would go up on top of the mountain, Joshua would stand at the bottom of the mountain waiting for him to come down. It didn't matter how long he was up there. Joshua would not leave his post, and he stayed right there until Moses came down. He was his assistant, very loyal, all right, extremely loyal. God said, that's the man who's going to take your place. Moses didn't complain about it. He just simply brought him before the people. He said, this is the guy who's going to step in my place. He laid his hands upon him, conferring upon him the leadership anointing. And then soon after that, he passed away. So what was God saying to Joshua? Not the obvious that Moses was dead, but he was simply saying, look, I've given you 30 days to mourn. It's time now to close up shop, pack your tents, and let's go forward. It's time to move into the promised land. It's time to get going. It's time to get to work. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise. Now arise. Cross this Jordan, you and this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the sons of Israel. In other words, it's time to get up and get moving. That was then, this is now. Now, it's not that it's not that people didn't appreciate Moses. It's not that they didn't, you know, and I'm sure they very well did, but you know something, there was a change in regime. There was a change in leadership. It was time now to move ahead into the next phase that God had for them. And they could not do that if they looked back. Amen? There was still a river to cross, and there was still a land to conquer. One of the things that happens, especially in churches, one of the things that happens so many times is we don't prepare for a change. See, you have a pastor who takes you to the XYZ place, but now there has to be somebody to take you to the next phase. And so what we have to do is make sure that we hear from God, so we make the preparation so that then when the time comes, that person is not only in place, but everybody knows this is the next person. And guess what? When the time comes, they take the reins and they lead and everything keeps going. But we don't do that in the church today. Part of the reason is sometimes we pastors don't want to let go. The other part of the reason is sometimes the people don't want to let go. So we have to have two things happen. We have to have the people willing to accept what's in front of them. And the other thing is we have to have the pastors willing to say, I'm going to groom the next person. And we ought to always be doing that, grooming people to take our place. Not only just as pastor, but at every level of the church. Oh, y'all don't sound too enthusiastic. Let me give you an example. Church I grew up in. Pastor was a great guy, started the church in 1954. Wonderful man of God. It came time for him to go. So a year before that happened, he went and got the man that God told him to get, brought him to the church. For a year, that man was his assistant. Great. Everybody loved him. Then when the pastor said, okay, I'm leaving now, I'm leaving you in the capable hands of this brother. He's going to take and he's going to lead the church on. Well, the pastor left. Brother took leadership of the church. And guess what happened? The people didn't accept it. They didn't accept it. So now there becomes all the fighting. All the push and pull, all the tug, all the this and that and the other, and you ain't this and you're not that, and you're not like Pastor. Well, of course he wasn't, because that was a different person. He is his own person. Joshua was not going to be a Moses. He just wasn't. That was not his function. And so this pastor said, I'm not him. I'm me. I'm God sent me here to do that. And so it got to the point where the church is literally imploded. And so a church that had 1,600 people fell down to no more than a couple of hundred. It just literally imploded. It was so much infighting, so much tugging and pushing and arguments and church meetings about, oh, why are you doing this and why are you doing that? This is what we've always done. Well, what you always done was great under him, but now we've got to keep moving forward. See, they were always looking back. They were always looking back at, well, when Pastor was here, we did this and we did that. Well, that was then. This is now. And so we can't sit around and talk about, okay, what we did then. It's time to move forward into the next phase of this ministry so that we can do what God would have us to do. Amen? See, the test of faith is always, always in front of you. That's just not going, that doesn't just go for a church or Israel, but it also goes for you personally. The test of faith is always, always in front of you. One of the things about Israel was the previous generation to Joshua's generation, to the people that Joshua was leading, that previous generation had to decide whether or not to cross the Jordan River and go into Canaan. They had to make that decision. Amen? The present generation that Joshua was leading had to make the same decision. The previous generation made the wrong decision. They said, we're not going there. Amen? This was the faith test. It was a test to see if we're going to believe God and do what God says. If God says go, we go. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter what we think it might be. It's what God has said. What has God said about it? God said go. It's our job to go. Amen? So it's a faith test. Why is it a faith test? Because we're stepping out in faith. Because we're moving in faith. Because we're hearing what God says. We're seeing with our eyes what's going on, and it doesn't look real pleasant. But we understand that God said go, regardless of the circumstance. And so we step out and we go. We may not understand always everything that God is telling us to do, but if we're going to walk by faith and not by sight, then we have to say, okay, we're going. We're going to do this. We're going to make it happen because God said do it, so we're going to step out there and go forward. Oh, yeah, but you know what? Look what when you stepped out here before, look what happened. I can't look back at what happened before. I can only look forward to what God is saying for me to do. Amen? So this is the faith test that Israel had to come to terms with. Was this new generation of Israelites going to step across the Jordan River, or were they going to stand where they were and look and say, well, you know, my mom and dad told me about what was going on over across the Jordan River. They said that there was a land of giants over there. They said the sons of Anak, oh, man, we were grasshoppers in their sight. These people are huge. We can't fight them. We can't beat them. We're just nothing but ex-slaves. These people have been warriors all their lives. You can take that if you want to, but that will stop you from ever becoming what God would have you to become. And the end result for those people who believed that they could not obey God because there were giants in the land, they died right there in the wilderness. In fact, the previous generation, every time a problem arose, the first thing they always said was, it was better for us back in Egypt. Exodus 16:2-3 says, the whole congregation of the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses. It was that first generation coming out of Egypt. Grumbled against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The sons of Israel said to them, "Would that we had died by the Lord's hand in the land of Egypt when we sat by the pots of meat." See, we had plenty. We ate good. "When we ate bread to the full. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." We ate good in Egypt. We had bread to the full. We were able to fill ourselves up on bread. We had meat in the pots. Out here we have nothing. You brought us out here to die. See, they were still looking back. They didn't talk about, here again, the good old days. The good old days, man, we ate bread and we had meat. Yeah, but you were slaves. Yeah, but they were putting a whip to your back. Yeah, but we had meat in the pot. We had onions and leeks and this and that and the other. Oh, man, we had it good. But yet you were forced to make brick all from sun up to sundown. Many of you died out there. No, that wasn't the good old days. You might have had some food, but that's nothing compared to what God has for you. He's got a land waiting for you that's flowing with milk and honey. Listen, for some of you in here, God has a plenty waiting for you, but you've got to step out in faith and take his faith test and say, "Lord, I'm leaving what's behind me, and I'm going forward." Listen, everybody can tell you what you can't do. Everybody can tell you how you'll never make it. Everybody can tell you that you're no good. But God says to you, because you are a child of God, you are made in his image and his likeness, you have the God breathe in you. And God is saying, you are more than enough to go out and do what I've called you to do. If you will believe God and step out in faith, despite how it looks, despite what you've been told, despite how many doors have been slammed in your face, step out anyway. And know God is going to take care of you. Listen, these are unprecedented times that we're living in. When I mean unprecedented times, I'm not talking about COVID. I'm talking about the fact that we are on the cusp of a change. Something is about to happen. And when I say something, I'm telling you, there's about to be a great change that happened. And the church has got to be ready so we can step out in faith. Because if we're not, then we'll get swept up in everything else and we'll lose a great opportunity. But there's an opportunity for the church right here, right now, today. There's an opportunity for us to cross the Jordan. There's an opportunity for us to go into the land flowing with milk and honey. There's an opportunity for us to step out and obey God and pass the faith test. Because if we don't pass the faith test, then what's going to happen? Then we'll die with everybody else. Come on, somebody. When the spies came back with the report, talking about how the land was full of giants, the Bible says in Numbers 14, 1 through 4, then all the congregation, after hearing the evil report, the Bible calls it an evil report, because the report they should have brought back would have been a good report. What's the good report? The good report is what God has said. The evil report is the report that contradicts what God is saying. It says, then all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried. And the people wept that night. All the sons of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Now, that's not what God said. That's what they surmised. But God said they're going to go in and take the land. They said we're going to die and be cut down by the sword. Listen to what he says. Our wives and our little ones will become plunder. Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? They're going to kill us men, take our wives and our little ones, and use them for themselves. So they said to one another, listen to what they said, let us appoint a leader and return to slavery. Let us appoint a leader and return to slavery. What a terrible attitude. What a terrible way to think. What a terrible way to look at yourself, that God has delivered me. I've seen it with my own eyes. 10 great miracles that God put upon the Egyptians just to get us out of there. And now we're talking about going back? That's crazy. That's insanity. But when you're afraid, when you're operating in fear, that's what you do. You do stupid things. You say stuff that doesn't make any sense. When you're operating, when you're so afraid of, we were over there and we saw these giants. Oh, my God, what are we going to do? We're going to go and take the land. Caleb stood up in the midst of them and said, let us go up at once. He said, let us not delay. Let us go up at once. Come on, get ready. Let's go at once and possess the land. They are bread for us. In other words, they are nothing. Let's go and take what belongs to us, because God has given it to us. They fail. They believe the evil report. The result of their failure is they died. The very thing they said, God said, "That's you want to die? That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to let you die." So they died in the wilderness because they chose not to go forward. How many of us are dying because we choose not to go forward? There's no turning back. Look, you're committed. You're a Christian. You're in this thing. Ain't no turning back. I don't think y'all heard me. There's no turning back. See, this is what most pastors will tell you. Oh, well, you know, God understands it. God understands. Listen, God didn't understand that. God did not understand that. God didn't sit there and say, well, Moses, I know they're weak. I know they're not able. You know, one of the things the Lord told Moses, look this up for yourself. One of the things the Lord told Moses, he told Moses, he said, look, I'm going to send these people into the promised land. They're going to get there. He says, and I already know. God knows everything in advance. He said, they're going to serve other gods. They're going to get rich. They're going to get fat. And they're going to turn to other gods. They're going to worship other gods, other things. They're going to do everything else aside other than worship me. But I'm taking them there anyway. God already knew they weren't going to do right. But he sent them anyway. Why? Because he has a plan. And despite how much, you know, people say, oh, yeah, look at what's going on in the church. Look at how people are acting. Look what people are doing. Look at this and look at that. Look what these pastors are doing. Look at this and look at that. You know something? Yes, and God knew all that, but he still has a plan. He still has a plan. And I don't care if every other pastor in the city is doing wrong. There's going to be a few of us who aren't doing wrong, because God has a plan. God always reserves for himself people who are going to go forth and keep his word, who are going to move forward, who are not going to stand still, who are not going to look back. God always has people. He told Elijah, he says, look, I got 7,000 who never bowed their knee or bowed their knee to Baal or kissed his ring or kissed his hand or whatever they were kissing. I don't know. He said, I got 7,000 who haven't done. He said, so it's not everybody has gone astray but you. I got some in reserve, Elijah. I got a people. And it may look like the world is going to hell in a handbasket. It may look like everything is just falling apart. But listen, let me tell you something. God has a people. God has a people. We may not be the majority, but we don't have to, because God can win with many or he can win with a few. It's not about the numbers with God. It's about committed hearts. It's about people who are willing to take the faith test and pass it. It's about people who are willing to go forward. It's about people who don't want to dwell in the past and yesterday, but are saying, let me see what tomorrow holds. Let's go forth, Lord. I'm anxious. I'm ready. I'm willing. There's something we got to do. And guess what, Lord? I'm willing to do it. You can dwell on your own past about what you've been through. Or what you did. Let me tell you something. I wish I could go back, but I don't have a time machine in my basement. Well, I don't even have a basement. But if I did, and I don't, but I don't have a time machine. I can't go back and change anything. But what I can do is change today and make sure tomorrow I obey God. See, that's the devil's work. When the devil sit around, they tell you, oh, but look, you didn't do this when God told you. And you didn't do that when God told you. And you didn't do that when God told you. See, when you, he got, and you know, he's right sometimes. But you can either say, oh, man. Or you can say, shut up, devil. Because see, that's not the voice of the Lord reminding you of what you didn't do. That's the devil telling you, see, you can't do this today because you didn't do that yesterday. And you've got to be able to say, shut up, devil. I might have blew it yesterday, but I'm not going to blow it today. I'm not going to miss it today. Hey, I'm passing a faith test today. Amen. Second point is the work of faith was right in front of them. You say, what's the work of faith? Well, faith is action. Amen. It was, see, it was time for the actual move, gathering the people across the Jordan River. Faith is action. It's more than just talk. It's doing. You know, anybody can get in church and raise their hand and say, oh, yeah, praise God. I just love God. And I believe him. Well, when all of a sudden when the pressure comes, who do you really believe? Because who you really believe, is going to come out in what you say and how you act. It's going to come out in what you do. Do you stand strong and faithful with God? Or do you bow your knee to the statue of Nebuchadnezzar? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego didn't. See, when it came time, they put faith in action. Amen? They put faith to work. And they said, we're not going to bow to your statue. We're not going to disrespect you, but we're not going to bow to your statue because we serve God. And guess what? God is able to deliver us from whatever you want to throw at us. And if he doesn't, that's okay too. See, you've got to be willing to whatever. Hey, however God chooses to deliver you, whether he lets you die, that's deliverance because you're going on to heaven, or whether he delivers you in a miraculous fashion so the world can see the great hand of God. Either way, you've got to allow God to do what he chooses to do with you because he has a plan. He always has a plan. Amen? As James says, faith without works is dead. So the work of faith was in front of them. What was the work of faith for them? Actually getting themselves together and crossing the river. Amen? They had to actually get all together and say, ah, okay, here we go. It's time. Let's cross this river. And that's what they did. In fact, I thought I had it. Yes, I do. It's over in Joshua chapter 1, verse 10. Listen to what it says. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the midst of the camp and command the people, saying, prepare provisions for yourselves, for within 3 days you are to cross this Jordan. Listen, God told him, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now is the time. Get up and go. Joshua told the people, in 3 days we're moving, folks. We're not staying here another 30 days. We're moving. He says, prepare for provision. We're going to cross this Jordan to go in to possess the land which the Lord your God is giving you to possess it. Down in verse 16 it says, then answered Joshua saying, they answered Joshua saying, so Joshua, and he goes and gives a long speech about what's going to happen. They answered, listen how they answered, all that you have commanded us, we will do. And wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we obeyed Moses in all things, so we will obey you. Only may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Anyone who rebels against your command and does not obey your words and all that you command him shall be put to death. Only be strong and courageous. The people answered him back and said, we are ready. We are ready. Just like we obeyed the previous man, we're now going to obey you. Because you're in charge now. You're the one that God placed in charge to lead us. And wherever you command us to go, we're going. Wow. Now, that's a whole different mindset from the previous generation. The previous generation cussed Moses and Aaron out and said, we're going to go back to Egypt. We're going to appoint people to send us, take us back to Egypt. This generation said, Joshua, we recognize your authority. We recognize that you are the man of God now. Let's go. You said we're going to leave in 3 days. Hey, we can leave today. We are ready. And anybody that doesn't want to do it, we're going to put them to death. They ain't going to be with us. And they're not just going to stand back here and sit and just stand here. No, if they're going to stay here, they're going to die. Because we're not leaving anybody alive behind. That's, come on now, that's tough, isn't it? That is tough. So here we had this work of faith, them saying, yes, let's go. And so now, the next thing after they cross, you have what I like to call the battle of faith. The battle of faith that's in front of you. Because the first city they came to when they crossed the Jordan was what? Jericho. So they had the faith test to go. Then they had the work of faith to actually get up and do it. Now you come to a city that is fortified. They say, even modern times, they say the wall of Jericho was so thick that you could run 3 or 4 chariots along the wall. It was just that wide. In other words, the walls of Jericho were probably wider than this building. They were very, very tall, and they were wide. This was a very fortified city. When they shut the door, nobody could get in. They didn't have to worry about being defeated by an enemy because nobody could get past their walls. In fact, their walls were so thick that people lived in the wall. That's where Rahab lived. Her house was in the wall. Wow. And so the Bible says in Joshua 6:1, now Jericho was tightly shut because of the sons of Israel. They saw them crossing the Jordan. They saw them coming. So they battened down the hatches, as they say. No one went out and no one came in. The Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand. Now, what they saw was a well-fortified city that most armies could not beat. They could very well defend themselves against most armies. And here this word, they were a ragtag bunch of people who just came out of slavery about 40 years ago. They're not a real army, per se, not trained as an army, but God said, I've given you this city. There was a strategy that God had for giving them Jericho first, to send them that way first. Because by defeating Jericho, they then took the wind out of the sails of every other city that thought that they might be able to beat Israel. By defeating Jericho and by totally destroying all of Jericho, everybody else in the land, trust me, that word spread, they beat Jericho. They went in and destroyed Jericho. That just took the fight out of everybody else. It says, so now Jericho was tightly shut because of the sons of Israel. No one went out, no one came in. The Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand with its king and the valiant warriors. So they had warriors. You shall march around the city, all the men of war circling the city once. You shall do so for 6 days. And 7 priests shall carry 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. Then on the 7th day you will march around the city 7 times, and the priest shall blow the trumpets. When the priest, once the priest blew the trumpets, the people then would shout, and he said the walls will fall flat. The battle of faith. And sometime during the battle of faith, you may do something that looks utterly foolish. I can guarantee you this. As the people of Jericho stood on that wall and looked down, and they saw, on the first day, they saw Israel walk around the city. Here are the priests with the 7 horns, and they're walking around the city. Nobody's saying a word. Then they go back to camp. Everybody was like, what? What just happened? They just walked around. Day number 2. They came out again, the priests with 7 horns, and they walk around the city. They walk around. As soon as they make their complete circle around the city. Now, I mean, you know, it's a lot of people, a lot of warriors, hundreds of thousands of warriors. And so they march around this city, and march all the way back to camp. Day three, same thing. Day four, day five, day six. So by this time, the people of Jericho probably are making sport of them. Hey, what you doing down there? Why are you walking on? Hey, walk a little bit for me too. You know, probably saying all that kind of crazy stuff. But the seventh day was a little different. Because instead of walking around once and then going back to the camp, they walked around a second time. Hey, now this is different. Then a third time. Then a fourth time. Then a fifth time, then a sixth time. By this time, I'm sure the king, everybody else is up there looking like, what? They just keep walking. They just keep walking. I mean, I thought they just walk around once and go back to the camp. We kind of got used to that. And then on the seventh time, as they began to walk around, the priest blew the trumpets. And then Joshua said, at my signal, you will all shout. And as they blew the trumpets, Joshua gave the signal, and all the people shouted. Can you imagine hundreds of thousands of warriors walking around shouting all at once? What a battle cry. What a sound. That sound carried on for miles, not just a mile or two, but I'm sure that sound carried on for hundreds of miles. I'm sure neighboring cities were like, what is that? What is going on? And they didn't realize that shout, that sound, was the sound of Jericho's destruction. And at the shout, as they began to shout, all of a sudden the ground started shaking. But they kept marching. They kept going. They kept going. See, because they understood one thing. They stood, hey, Joshua said, this is what you do. You don't do anything. Don't run. Don't hide. This is what we do. And God's going to give us the victory. And as they kept doing it and kept doing it and kept shouting and kept shouting, all of a sudden there was a rumble in the ground. The people sitting on top of the wall, people in the city, like, what is going on? What's happening? And it started shaking, more and more shaking. Now, the Bible says this very specifically. The walls didn't fall inward. They didn't fall outward. They fell flat. A chasm must have opened up beneath the walls. And all around the city, the wall just dropped. Except for that portion of wall where Rahab lived, because they promised her that they would rescue her and her family. I guarantee you, Rahab not only had herself in there, all her brothers and sisters, her mom and daddy, her aunts, uncles, cousins, she probably had everybody she could think of, you know, Pookie, Ray Ray, all y'all, come on in. she had everybody in there, because they said, if you're in the house, you survive. If you're in the house, they probably were stacked up like cordwood up in that house. But when that wall fell flat, that section when they were in, it dropped to level ground. Joshua said, now go and rescue Rahab and her family. For the rest of y'all, go forward into the city. The Bible says in Joshua 6:20, so the people shouted, and priests blew the trumpets. That's the victory of faith. The shout is the victory of faith. And when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted with a great shout. The wall fell down flat so that the people went up into the city. In other words, they didn't have to climb anything. They just walked right in. Every man straight ahead, and they took the city. They utterly destroyed everything in the city, both men and women, young and old, and ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of the sword. Because God said, this city belongs to me. You kill everything that moves and everything that breathes, because it's mine. Wow. That's the victory of faith. When you go in, you've had the test of faith. You then committed yourself to do it. And now you get to where you see the battle and you step in and you're ready to step into the battle, unflinching. You will have the victory. And in the victory comes a shout. And when you shout that victory, man, I'm telling you, even the demons in hell tremble with the shout of a faith victory. Every devil in hell trembles because a saint has had victory over their adversary, have had victory because they have believed God, have had victory because they were walking by faith and not by sight, have had victory because God has given them the command. They obeyed and they saw the hand of God move, and nothing could stop them or hold them back. They had victory, and you can always shout the victory. Listen, it's time to shout the victory. Nothing shakes up a devil more than a victorious saint. More than a saint who has won, who's overcome. Moses is dead, but we're going forward. That may have been then, but this is now. And each one of you are going to have your faith test. You say, I had one last year. You're going to have one this year. You're going to have one next year. You may have one next month. Listen, faith tests always come. Why? Because God is putting you to the test. He's saying, look, are you willing to take a step? Are you willing to believe my word? Are you willing to go forward? Are you willing? And if you say yes, come on, that's the test right there. He's looking for somebody to say yes. He's looking for somebody who's willing to go forward. He's looking for somebody who's saying, yes, Lord, send me. I'll go. I'll do it. It doesn't matter what it looks like. I don't care what the odds are. That angel came to Gideon while he was hiding and called him a mighty man of valor. Gideon had to look around and say, who are you talking to? Mighty man of valor, who are you talking to? I'm hiding. But the angel said, I'm talking to you. You may not know it yet, but you're a mighty man of valor. See, some of us don't even know who we are yet. Some of us don't know what we're capable of yet. Some of us haven't realized that there's a faith test ahead of us that's going to bring some stuff out of us that's going to make us more than what we ever been before. There's some of us don't realize that God is about to open a door in your life and expose some stuff that he's planted there a long time ago. Because now is our time. Now is our time. And God's going to open that door up. And you may have always thought of yourself as lackluster, but now you're about to shine. Now you're about to step out in God's majesty and his glory, with full of his honor, amen, wearing his armor. And you're about to go forth and do some things. There's a faith test for each and every single one of us. God has reserved the people, you and me. And now it's time. I believe this message is timely. It's not just something to stir you up a little bit, but it's something to get you ready for the test that's about to come. Because this hour, today, is the day the church needs to stand up and take its authority, take its control, and move forward in the Lord. We've bowed and scraped to the world far too long. We've bowed and scraped to the world far too long. We may look foolish, like walking around a walled city that's impenetrable. We may look like we don't know what we're doing. I mean, after all, what God had them do was not a battle tactic. That was not a way to fight a war. That's not a way to subdue a city. You see, God is unconventional. That means we're unconventional. See, going against hundreds of thousands of soldiers with a man named Gideon and 300 soldiers. Huh? They did a movie about the 300 what was that place? The 300 Sparta. They need to do a story about Gideon and his 300. Because that one is true. The other one is a fable, but that one is true. And you take 300 men, 300 against hundreds of thousands who camped out against you. 300. And you run toward the enemy with torches. And you're shouting again the victory shout. The sword of the Lord and Gideon. The sword of the Lord and Gideon as they're running. The Bible said the people got so confused, the other army got so confused, they pulled out their swords, they began to kill each other. By the time Gideon and his group got there, all they had to do was mop up. That's unconventional warfare. See, that's not according to the book, but it's according to this book. So don't look around and say, well, that doesn't make sense. If it doesn't make sense, I know it's God. that's not quite logical. Man, it must be God, because only God would have me go out and do something like this that doesn't even quite make sense. But God says, go out. Get ready. This is the time. It's time for your faith test. Have you been blessed today? I pray these messages are stirring you up, because trust me, we are at that point where we've got to begin to move forward. I'm not just talking about kingdom first. I'm talking about the church. It's got to move forward. That doesn't mean everybody else is going to move forward with us, but we'll move forward. We'll take the faith test. We'll go. We've already done a part of it. Now we got to just continue on. You know, we can't rest on what we did 4 years ago. We got to keep moving. We got to keep doing this. We got to keep striving, because it's for the glory of God. It's for the glory of God. For the glory of God. Amen. All right, without any further ado, you may be seated. We're going to ask those who are, if you need prayer this morning, if you're sick, whatever you're going through, and prayer is just not for sickness, it's for anything that you're facing, anything you're dealing with, then we're going to ask you to, for those who are here, stand right there where you're at your seat, just stand up. For those who are watching by streaming live, we're going to ask you to why don't you do this? Why don't you stand too? Whether you're in your kitchen, your living room, wherever, stand up and receive the prayer, receive the word that's going to go forth for you. Because God wants to heal you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to bring you through your problems. He wants to manifest himself in your life so that you can see the miraculous power of God. You know, I was just thinking on this morning. God created the heavens and the earth. And we say that so kind of, you know, nonchalantly. But he created the heavens and the earth. He created, he himself made all of this. Everything we can see, as far as we can see with our most powerful telescopes, he created it. He made it. And even that which we don't see, he made by the word of his power. He spoke the worlds into existence. Well, if he can speak the worlds into existence and do all those things, surely he can heal you. Surely he can command cancer to be gone. Restore hearing. Restore eyesight. Restore limbs that have been lost. Surely he can bring you out of whatever dire circumstance you're in. Surely he can bring finances into your hands. Oh, Lord, I need $20,000. He can bring if he created the universe, and they say that there's asteroids out there that are nothing but solid gold, tons and tons of solid gold. Well, if he left all that out there, surely he can bring take a little chunk and put in your hand. But we've got to believe it. We've got to be able to see it, know it, and say, Lord, yes, you who created everything and created me, you can fix me. You can heal me. You can deliver me. You can help me through. You can bring me forth. I know it. I know it. I know it, because you have created everything. And there's nothing too hard for God. Father, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, we release your healing anointing. And I don't have to release it. It's already here, Lord. It's already here. You have released healing and deliverance and everything we need. You have already released it throughout all the earth. All we have to do is have faith to receive it. And so today we have faith, and we apply our faith to receive healing in our bodies, deliverance in our lives. Whether it's a circumstances outward or inward, I declare we have been delivered. We are healed because Jesus took the stripes on his back 2,000 years ago. We are healed in Jesus' name. And it doesn't matter what the disease is, whether it's curable or incurable, we are healed in Jesus' name. You need to grab a hold to it. You need to take it. Those who are watching, you need to take hold to it right now. Just reach out and grab hold and say, it's mine right now, Lord, because you gave it to me 2,000 years ago. And I receive it today. Father, in Jesus' name, bring forth the finances into people's hands. Some are going through some dire circumstances. But Father, let the people of God always be above and not beneath, the head and not the tail. Always be financially full. In Jesus' name, we give you glory, honor, and praise. Amen and amen. All right, amen. Praise God.
We are grateful you chose to join us today for Pastor Dave's teaching. If you have questions during the week or are in need of prayer, please email us at office@kingdomfirstfw.com, and be sure to join us for our next broadcast. During this time, please remember to be safe, be well, and be blessed.